don't write, don't look in anything. Liver abscess, pyogenic liver abscess and amoebic liver abscess. You all know, very easy topic. We'll finish off in 15 minutes or so, right? Pyogenic liver abscess, usually seen in males. If you want to write, you can write as a table, pyogenic and amoebic. I'll tell you the differences as and when necessary. So, pyogenic liver abscess seen in males in 1.5:1 ratio, while amoebic abscess 10:1, males 10:1. Okay, we'll write the differences as and when necessary. Come to pyogenic abscess. So, what are the sources of pyogenic liver abscess? From where can liver be infected? Right. Number one is biliary tract. You have a CBD, right hepatic duct, left hepatic duct combined to form a common hepatic duct with the cystic duct. That is CBD. Within the CBD, there can be a stone or there can be a carcinoma, hilar cholangiocarcinoma, or parasite, some obstruction to the CBD, right? This can cause infection in the liver or abscess in the liver. One source is CBD, biliary. Another is portal vein. So, most of the liver gets its blood from portal vein. 70% of the blood to the liver is from portal vein. How does this portal vein form? Superior mesenteric vein joining with the splenic vein forming the portal vein, right? Splenic vein, inferior mesenteric vein will join the splenic vein. Splenic vein will join the superior mesenteric vein posterior to the pancreas, head of the pancreas or neck of the pancreas, and forms the portal vein, right? This portal vein, what is the artery of second in midgut? Artery of midgut, foregut, midgut and hindgut. Midgut starts from second part of duodenum up to mid transverse colon approximately, right? After that it is hindgut, right? Midgut is supplied with artery of midgut is superior mesenteric artery, while artery of the hindgut is inferior mesenteric artery. So, the veins parallel the course of the arteries. Clear? Superior mesenteric vein will parallel the course with the artery, will drain the blood from the GIT to the and joins with the inferior and splenic vein to form the portal vein. So, any infection in the GIT starting from the second part of the duodenum, say it can be ileum, Meckel's diverticulitis, it can be appendicitis, it can be colitis, it can be diverticulitis, whatever infection is there in the GIT, that can spread to liver via portal vein. Or in females, pelvic inflammatory disease, salpingitis, pelvic inflammatory disease. So, all these infections can spread via the means of portal vein. Previously, infection via portal vein was the most common cause and appendicitis was the most common cause of liver abscess. But nowadays, the most common cause of liver abscess is cryptogenic. So, what is cryptogenic? Which is equal to idiopathic. No cause, no reason. Most common cause now is cryptogenic. If in the options cryptogenic is not there, your best, second best option is biliary tract, CBD, via CBD. That too in the CBD, in the Western people, in the foreigners, it is because of hilar cholangiocarcinoma, while in our Indian setup, it is because of the CBD stones. Clear? So, most common cause of liver abscess now is cryptogenic, followed by biliary, followed by portal vein, right? Next, suppose there is a systemic infection like endocarditis, osteomyelitis or pneumonia, right? By means of arterial spread, liver will also get blood from hepatic artery. By means of the arterial supply hepatic artery, liver can be infected. Clear? Another source of infection to the liver is trauma, any trauma, right? Another source is direct extension. What are the organs or things adjacent to the liver? Gallbladder, cholecystitis. Can it cause liver abscess? It can cause liver abscess, cholecystitis. And adjacent you have duodenum. Posteriorly you have right kidney, right? You have diaphragm, subphrenic abscess can cause liver abscess. Okay. And perigastric collections adjacent to stomach all these direct invasion to the kidney can cause liver abscess. All these are the sources of liver abscess. Clear? Most common organism in liver abscess, polymicrobial, means many bacteria are there. Out of which bacteria is most common? Gram-negative bacteria are common. Out of gram-negative, which is most common? E. coli is most common. Right? You have attached your sleep to your friend. Now you are okay, he is sleeping. E. coli. Right? After E. coli, Klebsiella. Okay? Now, in children and immunocompromised persons, immunocompromised, you know, already we discussed HIV, chronic renal failure, and in chronic granulomatous disorders, whenever there is a immunodeficiency, children and chronic granulomatous disorders, most common organism to cause liver abscess will be Staph aureus. Clear? So most common is polymicrobial, which polymicrobial, gram negative, and anaerobic, both will be there. Out of gram negative, which is most common? E. coli, Klebsiella. And now in children or immunocompromised or chronic granulomatous disease, it will be Staph aureus. Now the specialty of Klebsiella causing abscess is there will be gas in the abscess. There will be air. Gaseous abscess, gaseous liver abscess is caused by Klebsiella. Another feature of this Klebsiella is it can cause endophthalmitis. Intrinsic endophthalmitis, not extrinsic. Eye has not acquired the Klebsiella organism from the environment. It has acquired from the liver. Intrinsic endophthalmitis, most common cause is Klebsiella. Clear? Now, how do this liver abscess present? Pyogenic liver abscess present. Pyogenic liver abscess most commonly presents with abscess anywhere will present with fever, chills and constitutional symptoms. Nausea, vomiting, anorexia, all those are constitutional symptoms. Most common presentation is fever with chills. So, jaundice is not frequent. Jaundice is seen in only 20 to 25% of the cases. Clear? There can be hepatomegaly. Hepatomegaly in 50% of the cases. Okay? Constitutional symptoms, fever with chills, jaundice and hepatomegaly. Now, how do you investigate? What is the first investigation you are supposed to do in a liver abscess? When you suspect a liver abscess, there will be intercostal tenderness on clinical examination. There can be increased liver span. There can be jaundice, patient having fever. He is an alcoholic with an age of about more than 50 years, male, presenting with these symptoms and history. You have to suspect liver abscess. And first thing you do is get an ultrasound examination of the abdomen. What will ultrasound examination of the abdomen will reveal? Will reveal a hypoechoic focus. It will reveal abscess only when there is an abscess. How does it will look in ultrasound? Ultrasound, you talk in terms of echogenicity because it is Doppler based, sound wave. CT, you talk in terms of density, hyperdense or hypodense. MRI, you talk in terms of intensity, hyperintense or hypointense. Now, how does a liver abscess look on ultrasound? It looks hypoechoic, not hyper. Hyper is more, hypo is low. Hypoechoic with irregular margins, right? And suppose if it is Klebsiella, there can be a air fluid level, which can be also seen in plain x-ray of the abdomen. If you do a plain x-ray, how do you diagnose intestinal obstruction? Air fluid levels, doing a x-ray erect abdomen. So when you take a x-ray of the abdomen in liver abscess, what happens? The right dome will be pushed more higher up. So because of liver abscess, there can be basal, right lung consolidation or atelectasis. There can be pleural effusion. There can be air fluid level. Right? All these things can be seen in a x-ray, chest x-ray. So we don't prefer it as a first investigation. First investigation is ultrasound. So you have seen a hypoechoic focus. Next. Usually ultrasound is enough. But when you have your diagnosis in doubt, when you suspect a malignancy, sometimes what happens is hepatocellular carcinoma can undergo necrosis. A part of the carcinoma can undergo necrosis. It can become infected and it can form abscess. So you are not sure whether it is a carcinoma or a only liver abscess. At that time you can do a CT of the abdomen. What is the advantage of doing CT scan of the abdomen? You will also know the intra-abdominal pathology. This liver abscess can be because of appendicitis. This liver abscess can be because of PID. We have just now discussed. See? So, other intra-abdominal organs can be assessed doing a CT scan. But don't say it is routinely done. Right? First investigation is always an ultrasound. So, how does it look in a CT, liver abscess? The major difference between an amoebic abscess and liver abscess in the CT is there will be peripheral rim enhancement. In the first page I told you to put a difference table, no? There you write if you want. Pyogenic liver abscess, there will be a peripheral rim enhancement. While in amoebic liver abscess, there is no peripheral rim enhancement on CT. Apart from that, apart from CT, what you can do? You can do a MRI, which is not necessary, which does not give you more information than a CT in this case. It gives you more money from the patient if you order a MRI. That's it. So, no other investigation is essential. Imaging investigation. What blood investigation do you want to do? It's a liver. So, you have to do a liver function test, that is minimum. Whenever liver is damaged, what happens? There can be a impaired coagulation profile because liver synthesizes clotting factors. Liver synthesizes albumin. There can be hypoalbuminemia. There can be deficiency in clotting factors because of which there can be increased PT and INR, decreased serum total protein levels. Okay. So, most common liver function abnormality in pyogenic liver abscess is increased alkaline phosphatase. Why? Most common cause of liver abscess is? After cryptogenic, what is the most common cause in our Indian setup? Biliary. Whenever there is a biliary pathology, there will be obstructive jaundice. So, what is the pattern of enzyme elevation in obstructive jaundice? Increased alkaline phosphatase. So, in liver abscess, most common liver function abnormality will be increased alkaline phosphatase. While in amoebic abscess, most common liver abnormality is increased PTINR. Increased PTINR. Clear? Now, these are the investigation. Patient is there with you. Now, how do you treat? How do you treat liver abscess? Antibiotics. Excellent. Now, the treatment of choice for liver abscess is ultrasound guided percutaneous aspiration. Any abscess previously, you have to say treatment of choice is incision and drainage. Now, because of widespread use of ultrasound, the modality has changed. The choice is ultrasound guided percutaneous. You put a wide bore needle, aspirate the abscess, give antibiotics and observe the patient. Do a serial ultrasound. If it is healing, you can leave. If it is not healing with the percutaneous drainage of the abscess, then what you can do? Surgical drainage. Surgical drainage is not routinely necessary. Only when the percutaneous drainage of the abscess fails or when the abscess ruptures into the peritoneum. Okay, then you have to do surgical drainage of the abscess by a peritoneal toilet, keep it drain, close the abdomen and come out. Don't do anything else. Clear? So, give what antibiotic you want to give in liver abscess? You have to give a broad spectrum antibiotic because it is polymicrobial. What is broad spectrum? Most commonly available, ampicillin, injection ampicillin plus injection aminoglycoside. It can be gentamicin or amikacin. Ampicillin, gentamicin plus metronidazole. All the three combination you have to give. Or simply what you can give is a third generation cephalosporin. Third generation cephalosporin, parenteral. Can you name any? Ceftazim or ceftriaxone. Okay, ceftriaxone. Third generation parenteral cephalosporin with the metronidazole. Metronidazole is must. So, ampicillin, amikacin or gentamicin with metronidazole. Three. Or third generation cephalosporin with metronidazole. Yeah. So, whenever you suspect malignancy, right, CT is also suspicious of malignancy, then comes the role of surgery. Apart from rupture, we have just discussed, when do you do surgical drainage? Whenever it gets ruptured or whenever it is not healing, we'll do surgery. When you suspect malignancy also, you have to do hepatectomy, segmentectomy, right? Wide resection of the liver, not routinely done for completion sake. Clear? Now shall we go to amoebic abscess? Right? Amoebic abscess 10:1, male is to female. Okay, immunocompromised patients most commonly seen. Don't know why menstruating women, women who are menstruating are resistant to amoebic liver abscess. Right? In pregnancy, there will be stoppage of menstruation, right? So, because of which in pregnancy, females will become susceptible to amoebic liver abscess. So, diabetes, immunocompromised state, alcoholics and pregnancy, all these are risk for amoebic liver abscess. You know the life cycle. Pico oral route, right? What is the infective form? Fast. Cystic stage, tetranucleate cyst. What happens to the cyst? In the intestine, in the small bowel, it becomes what? It sheds the cyst wall, becomes a trophozoite, goes to the colon. In the colon or in the large bowel, what happens is there is a immunoglobulin A, IgA. This IgA is protective to the mucosa against this amoeba, against this trophozoite. So, whenever this IgA fails, or whenever the load of amoeba is more or virulence is more, it invades the colon and it reaches the liver and it forms an abscess. Most commonly, either pyogenic or amoebic, most commonly abscess are seen in the right lobe of the liver. Okay. The speciality of amoebic abscess is they are peripheral in location, peripheral, right? They cannot infect the Glisson's capsule. Capsule over the liver is Glisson's capsule. Glisson's capsule is comparatively resistant to amoebae than the liver parenchyma, right? It doesn't infect initially the Glisson's capsule. It stands as a peripheral region in the right lobe of the liver. Acute amoebic liver abscess less than 10 days duration will be multiple, while chronic amoebic liver abscess greater than 14 days, 2 weeks in duration will be solitary, right? Even the pyogenic liver abscess can be either solitary or multiple. In 50% of the cases, it can be solitary. In 50%, it can be multiple. It cannot. But most commonly, if you see a multiple abscess in the liver, think of a pyogenic liver abscess. Amoebic liver abscess is 80% mostly solitary. Okay. Now, again, same investigation. Right? You will do a ultrasound. You will do a CT. What is the difference? There is no peripheral rim enhancement in CT in amoebic abscess. So, apart from this, there is a scan called thallium scan and gallium scan. In the scans, what happens? This amoebic abscess will not show the uptake of thallium or gallium. So, uptake will be poor or absent in amoebic liver abscess. Thallium or gallium uptake will be seen in pyogenic liver abscess. Why? Because pyogenic liver abscess has leukocytes, WBC, within the abscess, while amoebic liver abscess have no leukocytes within the abscess. But in the blood there will be leukocytosis. Leukocytosis is increase in WBC. Right? What else you want to do for amoeba? You have to do a ELISA, serology for entamoeba. Right. After all these investigations, if you fail to diagnose or differentiate between a pyogenic and amoebic liver abscess, what you can do? You can aspirate. So, how does the amoebic liver abscess look? Anchovy sauce pus. Right. This pus will be sent to microbiologist to see for amoebae in the abscess. That is how you can diagnose. Serology or aspiration, anchovy sauce pus, or seeing amoebae. Now, what is the management of choice? Management here is giving a course of metronidazole, only metronidazole, 750 mg TID, 3 times a day for 14 days, 7 to 14 days, metronidazole. If the abscess resolves, then you can observe the patient. Even though abscess is resolving, patient will become better, but ultrasound wise, radiologically, if you see, the lesion will be same. Patient will be clinically improved early than radiological clearance of the abscess. Radiological clearance of the amoebic abscess will take about months, 4 to 6 months to see in the ultrasound, progress for us to see in the ultrasound. So you give what? Metronidazole. So when are you supposed to aspirate amoebic abscess? For pyogenic liver abscess, you are aspirating, that is percutaneous drainage of the abscess. Whenever amoebic liver abscess is in the left lobe, first point, whenever the abscess is greater than 5 cm, whenever there is a risk of rupture of the abscess, okay, whenever you have given the drug for 2 to 3 days, but patient is not improving clinically, so under these circumstances, you have to aspirate amoebic abscess, right? We don't do a regular aspiration of the amoebic abscess. You give metronidazole and observe. If there is no improvement clinically, not radiologically, in 2 or 3 days, or if abscess is greater than 5 cm, or it is a left lobe abscess, or if the abscess is about to rupture, then you have to aspirate. So what are the complications of this abscess? It can rupture into peritoneum, can cause peritonitis. It can rupture into pleura, can cause effusion. It can rupture into pericardium. Anything is possible, especially left lobe abscess can rupture. Another specialty of this amoebic abscess is it can cause brain abscess from the liver. What is this abscess called as? Metastatic abscess. Metastatic abscess from liver can infect brain. So brain abscess can be there. Sometimes this amoebic abscess can rupture onto skin. What is this called as? Amoebic cutis. Amoebic cutis. Clear? So shall we stop liver abscess? Actually, I have there are slides of how does it look like, but I am just unable to move this. So see, this is the hepatic abscess, hypoechoic area, with pleural effusion. This is the diagram of Ancovi sauce pus, amoebic pus. The life cycle you all know: trophozoites, multiplication, invading liver. Most commonly right lobe, risk factors. Rest of all, I think we have discussed. Pericarditis, peritonitis. Right, in amoebae, apart from treating the liver abscess, what you have to do is you have to also treat the intraluminal amoebic infection. For what you give, which drugs you give, which act intraluminally. Have you heard of diloxonate, diloxonate furoate, right? That you have to give. What are the tissue acting, invasive, anti-invasive drugs against amoeba? It is there on the screen actually. Emetin and chloroquine. Emetin is having more side effects, so we are not using. So you can use chloroquine. So apart from metronidazole, you have to also treat intraluminally with diloxonate furoate. And tissue invasive is emetin and chloroquine. Right? Sometimes there can be diarrhea. Amoebic abscess, liver abscess can present with the colonic abscess, both parallelly. In about 1/3 of case, both will present simultaneously. Most of the times what happens? The colonic abscess will be silent, only the liver abscess will manifest. Right? Patient can have diarrhea because of colitis. So clear? So pyogenic abscess and amoebic abscess, and just briefly the differences. So absence of peripheral rim enhancement in amoebae, no uptake of scan in amoebae, gallium or thallium scan, and immunocompromised state, male 10:1 ratio, male to female in amoebae, right? All these are differences. So mostly solitary 80%. If it is multiple, you have to suspect. I don't think I can stop here. Liver abscess.